Thanks very much. By now, I think most of you are probably familiar with what we mean when we say that an organism has a theory of mind. But just let me go over the basic classic experiment so that we're all on the same page. Imagine that you're sitting in front of a puppet show with a two-year-old child. And on the stage is a room with some furniture in it and a little puppet. And the puppet's named Maxie. And Maxie says to the child and you, the audience, I've got a piece of candy, and I really want to eat this piece of candy. But first, I have to go to the bathroom. So to make sure that nobody steals my candy when I'm out of the room, I'm going to hide it under the red sofa. And then Maxie leaves the puppet stage. And then you say, let's play a trick on Maxie. Let's take the candy out from under the red sofa and put it in the green cupboard. And then if you turn to the child of two and say, now, when Maxie comes back into the room, where is she going to look for her candy? And a child of two will say unhesitatingly, in the green cupboard. She knows that the candy is in the green cupboard, and she can't imagine that everybody doesn't know this. She can't distinguish between Maxie's knowledge and her own knowledge. And so she guesses incorrectly. If you ask a child of three or four or so, where will Maxie look for the candy when she comes back? As a child gets older, three or four or so, she will say, well, I don't know. And a child of four or five will say, she will look under the red sofa because that's where she thinks it is, but in fact, it's in the green cupboard. And so we use the term theory of mind in this case to describe this classic experiment done in 1979 because there's nothing about what Maxie is doing, nothing you can see when Maxie is out of the room that tells you that her knowledge is now false. You have to have, in David Premack's words, a theory about how the mind works and how the knowledge that a creature has affects that creature's behavior. You have to have that kind of theory, a theory of mind, to decide what Maxie will or will not do. And this is the sort of classic experiment that was first done on kids. And since then, there's been a sort of industry around the world of trying to determine how a theory of mind develops in children and whether or not having a theory of mind is a unique feature of human intelligence or whether we can find it in other species. So when we talk about an organism having a theory of mind, we're talking about something as elemental as sensitivity to others' attention and direction of gaze, social referencing, recognition of others' intentions and emotions, recognition of the difference between yourself and others, and so on and so forth. And there's been, as I said, a huge industry trying to determine whether or not this is a unique feature of human behavior. And there's been some suggestion that having a theory about what another organism knows or its belief states, whether it has false beliefs or not, that that's unique to humans. But I should say that this is fraught with all sorts of difficulty because it turns out that having a theory of mind is not an all or nothing ability. And both in ontogenetic studies of children and in comparative work on humans and animals, we can find gradations of a theory of mind. For example, an 18-month-old child will know readily that her sibling doesn't like broccoli. But if you ask her what her sibling knows or believes, she'll be sort of confused. Children learn about others in other individuals' wants and intentions or likes and dislikes long before they can articulate knowledge about what another individual knows or their false belief. And the picture is similarly graded when we look at comparative studies for animals. So that these elements of theory of mind are not discrete stages. They are very difficult to disambiguate, and they may often be very difficult to distinguish from sophisticated forms of associative learning that are widespread in animals. And so because this whole issue of whether or not a theory of mind is unique to humans or not has been so widely discussed and with so many different opinions, I'm not going to talk about it today. Instead, what I want to do is take a slightly different perspective and ask an evolutionary question, to ask how a theory of mind, whatever its manifestation, might have evolved in animals and humans. what its selective benefits have been. We now know enough about theory of mind across different species to be fairly confident that the elaborate, sophisticated theory of mind that we see in modern humans must have evolved from a more rudimentary form in animals. The question is, why? What benefits does having a theory of mind bring? How does it increase an individual's survival and reproduction? Why has it been favored by natural selection? In other words, what can we say about theory of mind in light of the theory of evolution? And I'm going to tackle this topic by reviewing some recent data on animals, particularly primates, baboons, and chimpanzees, that relate directly to the evolution of theory of mind in humans. At least I hope they will. And the argument that I'm going to make can be summarized as follows. First of all, crucial to theory of mind is an understanding of other individuals' intentions, emotions, and perspectives. These abilities, I'm going to argue, have evolved because natural selection has favored individuals who are motivated to empathize with others and attend to social interactions. And these skills have been favored because they're needed to form strong, enduring social bonds. And finally, getting to fitness, these strong social bonds enhance reproductive success. And that's a crucial element that has recently been discovered in wild primates that helps us move from the cognitive ability of having a theory of mind up to differential survival and reproduction. So the core of the argument is that the adaptive value of strong social bonds provides the key to understanding the evolution of theory of mind. So let's start at the very basic level. There's lots of data that suggests that there's an innate tendency in humans and many other animals to imitate or relate to or copy the actions, postures, and behaviors of another individual, particularly another individual with whom you're interacting often. For example, mirror neurons fire not only when you engage in a particular action, but also when you observe another individual engaging in a particular interaction. Many organisms, child and these dogs, follow each other's gaze instinctively when they see another looking in an area. And very soon after birth, young rhesus monkeys and young human infants imitate the facial expressions of an individual with whom they're interacting. Now, several authors have tried to divide this behavior into two categories, sort of reflexive, automatic, unconscious behaviors, reactions of individuals when they're really not aware of making the reaction, mirror neurons in the motor domain, gaze following, and pain, fear, and anxiety when you see these states in others, as against more reflective perspective taking on the part of the actor, where you're much more conscious and trying to do this. But it's been very clear that these distinctions are extremely hard to make, that it's difficult to tell what's conscious and what's unconscious. But there are some interesting patterns that are beginning to emerge. Here's one example, contagious yawning, which I hope no one in this room will now engage in for the next half hour. But there is this phenomenon of contagious yawning in humans. You see another individual yawn, it increases the likelihood that you will yawn. And it's interesting that viewing a yawn evokes neural activity in the same areas that are associated with empathy, that in several psychological tests, it's correlated with tests of face recognition and theory of mind. This kind of contagious yawning is rare in children under 4, and it's also rare in autistic individuals. Again, possibly correlated with the ability to form a kind of social bond. And even more intriguingly, it's more prevalent in family members, suggesting that this kind of emotional contagion is more likely to occur when the people are familiar with each other. There's also data on contagious yawning in chimps, possibly in dogs, a bit more controversial. And chimpanzees, too, suggest that contagious yawning may be linked to the formation of social relationships, because it's more likely to occur when the individuals are familiar and dominant with one another. And this link between what we can think of as emotional contagion, just as a descriptor, and close social bonds has cropped up again in several other experiments that are now sort of collectively being described as the chameleon effect. It turns out that humans are more friendly to those who reflexively imitate their body language. And this is also true of capuchin monkeys. There's a very nice experiment when capuchin monkeys are observed by humans, and if the humans imitate the monkey, then the monkey is more generous to the human afterwards. Interesting, male chimpanzees live in groups where they give these elaborate pant hoots to one another. And groups of males get together and pant hoot together. And if two males have a close social bond and interact often, over time, their pant hoots become acoustically more alike. And finally, people who score high on perspective taking show more imitative behavior in their social interactions. Now again, the proximate mechanisms are difficult to specify. It's hard to say whether this is reflexive and unconscious or reflective and conscious. They're really difficult to disambiguate. But the interesting suggestion is that there may be a functional relationship between this imitation and perceived empathy and the formation of social bonds. I should say that Dorothy just told me that there's an article in this week's New Yorker. It's an interview with a pickpocket, a professional pickpocket in New York. And they ask him how he does it. And he says the first thing that he does is make eye contact with his intended victim and sort of imitate that individual's behavior. And his argument is that immediately causes the guy to relax, and it makes it much easier to pick his pocket. It's an interesting sort of theory, but it relates to this idea that possibly this chameleon effect, this emotional contagion, might have something to do with social bonds. And one thing that is quite clear, but I should say that we don't know which way the causal arrow points. It may be that social bonds are formed for some other reason, and they lead to more emotional empathy and imitation, or it could be that emotional empathy and imitation helps to cause the social bonds. To an evolutionist, though, the mechanisms are not really that important. What's important is whether or not they are linked to bond formation. And I want to just talk a little bit about chimpanzees, because it's now quite clear that forming a social bond is emotionally rewarding to primates. Let me give you a bit of the background. Chimpanzees, as many of you probably know, live in large communities that range over huge areas. And within these communities, if you walked through there, you would encounter the same individuals every day. They live there all the time. But they come and go in little subgroups or foraging parties in an unpredictable way. You might find individual A by himself one day, with three females another day, with a couple of youngsters another day, with five other males and another day. It's simply unpredictable. It's called a fission fusion society, and it's quite unique in the animal kingdom. But within this society, the individuals, and this comes from long-term studies in Uganda and Tanzania, the individuals within these communities form long-lasting, enduring social bonds. They have friends. And these are not friends, male-female friends, that are associated with the mating and rearing of offspring. These are often male-male friends or female-female friends that are themselves adaptive, and I'll talk about that in a minute. But these friendships can last for 10, 15, 20 years. And they're a tremendously striking feature of the chimpanzee society, but one that we've only begun to understand in the last 5 or 6 years as these long-term studies have begun to draw a picture of chimpanzee behavior. Friendships seem to be rewarding. And here's an example from a paper that's about to be published. And work done by Kathy Crockford and colleagues at the Max Planck Institute in Leipzig, working on a colony of chimpanzees in Uganda. And what she did was she observed every opportunity of two chimpanzees grooming. They spend a lot of time grooming with one another. And she noted whether the individuals involved were individuals that were close genetic relatives, or individuals that had one of these long-term social bonds, or whether they fell into other categories, whether they were enemies, whether they were, you know, just occasional acquaintances. And after the grooming had ended, she and her associates collected a bit of urine from each of the individuals involved, and from the urine they extracted information about the levels of oxytocin, a hormone that's known to be associated with friendship and affiliation. And this is the results that they got. So for each individual, there was baseline data, there was the level of oxytocin after grooming, and then the level of oxytocin after grooming with kin, and finally, the level of oxytocin after grooming with non-kin, that oxytocin was higher after the grooming with non-kin. Now, there are several things that are important about this. The first is, as I said, these are not male-female bonds associated with reproduction. These are friendships. They're friendships that are often same-sex friendships between two males or between two females. The other is that they occur within the context of a broader society in which some individuals are friends and others are not. A much more complicated setting than we're used to thinking of. And finally, notice that it's not the act of grooming itself that is rewarding in the sense that it leads to higher oxytocin. It's grooming with a particular partner. So the distinction between who you're grooming with is extremely important. So given these data and getting back to our original hypothesis, we can argue that if empathy and social affiliation are under strong selective pressure and lie at the roots of theory of mind, we ought to be able to link these attributes to fitness. And in fact, there's growing evidence in a variety of species throughout the animal kingdom for just the same sort of long-term bonds we see in chimpanzees. And these long-term bonds have been related directly to fitness. For example, wild horses in the Camargue of the south of France, females who are more closely bonded with each other have higher survivorship in their foals. In these Assamese macaques, as in the chimps, as in dolphins off the coast of Western Australia, males that form close bonds that again may last for many years are better at acquiring and mating with females, at defending territories. They have a higher reproductive success as a result. And again, these bonds can last for long periods of time. Now, if this work on the adaptive value of long-term friendships is important in part because it links up very nicely with recent work on humans. The Longevity Project, for example, a long-term study of the correlates of longevity in Americans, has shown that the best predictor of how long you live is not material resources or education, it's whether or not you have a strong network of social companions, whether or not you've got a lot of friends. Work by Michael Marmot and others in the UK on the resilience of people to things like stress and cardiovascular disease shows that the best way to protect yourself against these major causes of death is to have a strong social network. So social bonding has been shown to be adaptive in humans, and long-term studies in a variety of different species are showing it to be adaptive in animals. So, armed with these data, we can restate our hypothesis a little bit more precisely. We can argue that possibly natural selection has favored individuals who have the skill and motivation to sustain close cooperative bonds, even when they're living in large, complex societies. And by skills, I mean the cognitive and emotional skills to keep track of other individuals' relationships and ranks and animosities, and to remember recent interactions, to remember and recognize other individuals' motivations and intentions, and be motivated to form bonds with others. Now, as you can see, many of these latter ideas are what we think of as overlapping with the skills in having a theory of mind. So the argument is that that selection is acting on those traits that prompt us to form social bonds, and those traits are theory of mind traits, certainly in both animals and in humans. And in fact, this hypothesis is what Dorothy Cheney and I have been studying and testing for the last Well, since 1992, in a group of wild baboons living in the Okavango Delta of Botswana. And I want to tell you a little bit about the results of our work and where it's taken us. But first, I want to tell you, as I did with chimps, about baboon society, because as you can imagine, if we're going to understand the evolution of these cognitive and emotional skills, we've got to understand the social environment in which they evolve. Baboons are very different from chimps. They're much more alike many other large animals like elephants and impala and lots of other creatures. So baboons live in a group, and all the members of the group go around together, and as a female young, they become sexually mature at about age 6, and at that point they stay in the group where they were born throughout their lives. And they maintain very close bonds with their mothers and their female siblings. Males, on the other hand, become sexually mature at about 7 or 8, and when they do so, they leave the group, and they go and join another group, and they move from group to group throughout their lives. So when you're looking at a large group of baboons, the core of the group, the stable membership, is a group of closely related females, mothers and their daughters and sisters and sisters. And if you watched and walked out with these baboons, you'd find that, there's one female. As she walks through the group, it's all very quiet and peaceful. Other animals sort of step aside. And there's another female who, as she walks through a group, people step aside, but not that one. Everyone steps aside for her. In other words, you'd quickly find that in these very simple, low-key approach-retreat interactions, there is a linear dominance hierarchy. And it turns out that when a daughter is born into the group, immediately at birth, she acquires a dominance rank immediately below that of her mother. And so do her sisters as they are born. So what you have as the core of a group of baboons is a ranked group of matrilineal families, where all the members of family A rank among all the members of family B, who rank among all the members of family C, down to the lowest ranking animal in the lowest ranking family. Females maintain close bonds with their matrilineal kin. They groom a lot with them. They don't necessarily forage together, but they support each other in an alliance if ever there is a fight. And so the relationships in many ways are simultaneously cooperative and competitive. They both compete with other individuals for access to resources and cooperate with other individuals, particularly their family members. And in fact, all of these females will breed. It's not like wolves where only the alpha female breeds and none of the others do. That's what we refer to as a high reproductive skew species. Baboons are very much a low reproductive skew species. So everyone is breeding. And there are some benefits to having other females in the group because it helps you defend your territory. So it's a society that is structured around matrilineal kinship and dominance rank. And for a long time, as these long-term studies proceeded, everyone thought, well, when we eventually get the data on survival and reproduction, it's going to be the high-ranking animals that are doing better. But it isn't. In fact, the best predictor of survival and reproduction in this baboon society is the strength of the bonds that you have with other females. And let me tell you how we came to that result. First of all, we wanted to measure bond strength with other females. And so working with Joan Silk, we created two indices that are kind of composites of social interaction. And one is the Composite Sociality Index, which is based on a variety of measures of behavior. And so an individual with a high CSI is one who interacts a lot with other females intensively. And we also looked at the Partner Stability Index, that is, how stable your preferred partners are from 1 year to the next. And then we wanted to see whether these measures were correlated with reproductive success. And this is what we found, that first of all, consider offspring survival. Now what we've done here, this is a survivorship curve, and we've divided the females that we've studied over 16 years into those with the strongest bonds with other females, intermediate bonds with other females, and the weakest bonds with other females. And this is offspring survival up to 15 years. everyone starts off there, and gradually they die off. But as you can see, females who have weak bonds with other females have the worst offspring survival. And females who have strong bonds with other females have the best offspring survival. And this tracks out long after the offspring have ceased to be dependent on their mothers for food, which happens about here at 1 year. Now you could say, well, maybe these ones in the red are just the ones whose mothers happen to live, because mortality is pretty high. But it's not whether or not you have kin in the group, it's the strength of your bond. Here's the data for only mothers and daughters. So all these, this sample of 123 dyads, everybody's alive for the whole time. And again, the strongest bonds have better offspring survival, the weakest bonds have the weakest offspring survival. And the same thing holds for longevity, that if we divide the group into these three categories and we look at lifespan, again, the longest lifespan are those that have the strongest bonds to other females. And all of this is independent of dominance rank and the presence or absence of kin. Some kin have close bonds with other kin, but some females in the group, for a variety of reasons, usually predation, don't have any kin, and yet they form bonds with other females. So it looks like that you can talk about a female's dominance rank and her kin relations, but that's only part of the story. This led us to assume that females who groom with others at high rates, they have a high CSI, they have better offspring survival, if they retain the same partners, they live longer. These differences can't be explained by dominance rank, so some females must be more skilled or motivated to establish social bonds with others. And so the question then becomes that there's something else going on here, something that we can think of as individual differences in personality. Individual differences in personality that can't be predicted simply by dominance rank or whether your mother is alive. So to test this hypothesis, we took all of the data on 45 females for 7 years, and we used principal components analysis to try and see if this kind of clustering analysis sorted them into groups that would allow us to identify individual differences that might in turn be related to the CSI and the PSI. We had a variety of independent variables, many different behaviors. We knew that in a society like baboons, if you find a personality trait that is correlated with dominance rank, well, that doesn't teach you anything because we already knew that dominance rank was very evident. If there's a personality trait that is apparent only if you have kin present in the group, well, that doesn't help either. We were looking for something that was independent of dominance rank and kinship. And we also measured stress that the individuals were under by collecting a fecal sample from each female each week for about 7 years and then extracting the glucocorticoid metabolites for this. I'll talk a little bit about that. And we also paid a lot of attention to grunts. And I just want to mention this because grunts in baboon society are a wonderful way of measuring how cooperative or how nice or how friendly a baboon is. If you were out watching baboons with us, you'd often see that one female would approach another and give a series of grunts. And especially if the approaching animal is higher ranking, the other animal can often be a little bit nervous and she shies away a bit. But the minute she hears the approaching animal grunt, she relaxes. And if a female grunts when she approaches, they're much more likely to interact, groom, stay together, touch each other. If the female approaching doesn't grunt, usually they split up. And this is particularly true when, and we get the feeling that low-ranking animals grunt to high-ranking animals just to sort of, say, appease them. Please don't attack me. High-ranking animals grunt to low-ranking animals to get them to relax, and all this is particularly true when the animal being approached has a baby, because female baboons love to handle babies, and yet the mothers are a little bit nervous. So if a high-ranking female approaches a low-ranking female and wants to handle the baby, if she grunts, she'll be able to. And low-ranking female, as nervous as she is, she really wants to handle this high-ranking female's baby. It's interesting. She'll grunt a lot. So in a sense, you could think of grunts as, in some cases, selfish. I grunt only to those females who I want to inhibit their aggression or I want to handle their baby. Or you could think of grunts as being sort of empathically nice. I'll grunt to anybody, baby, no baby, high ranking, low ranking, whatever. Maybe grunts would provide us a window into these different personalities. And we found that the loadings of the behaviors in this principal components analysis yielded three principal components that we described anthropomorphically or descriptively as loner, aloof, and nice. And the best way to think about this is to imagine that you've got a three-dimensional space. And these axes, loner, aloof, and nice, the axes are loner, aloof, and nice, and your score on those components, and that the individuals form these clusters. The clusters do overlap quite a lot, but there, and it is occasionally true that a female will move from one cluster to another, but by and large, females tend to remain in the same cluster across years. There are nice females. They're rarely alone, they're often approached, they're very friendly, touching and hugging others, and they grunt to everyone. There are loners that are often alone. They're rarely approached. They grunt only to high-ranking females, please don't attack me, and they have higher glucocorticoid levels. They're under a fair amount of stress. And finally, there are aloof females that are rather aggressive. They're rarely approached, and they grunt only to high-ranking females with infants. In other words, rather selfish in their ways. None of these things were affected by dominance, rank, or kinship. So they are personality dimensions that cut across the rank and kinship that such a dominant part of the society. Well, the question is, are they related to the composite sociality index and the partner stability index? Because those are related to fitness. And it turns out that they are. That as you get higher on the nice component, you have a higher composite sociality index. As you get higher on the loner component, you have a worse composite sociality index, with aloof somewhere in between. And as far as the partner stability index, nice, it's weakly positively correlated. As you get higher on the aloof component, you get a higher stability. Aloof animals are really stable. Loners show no effect. So to summarize these, nice animals are very friendly, they're seldom alone, they grunt to everyone, everyone approaches them, they have a high sociality component, but they're slightly more changeable in their partners over years. But it's clearly a set of traits that could be favored by natural selection because the more nice you are, the higher your CSI will be and the greater your fitness will be. Aloof animals are aggressive, seldom approached, grunt only to high-ranking females with infants for personal gain, and they have average sociality, but they're loyal. They have stable partners, and that's good because that increases your reproductive success. Loners are not very well off. Selection seems to be acting against them. They're rarely approached, they're often alone, they grunt only to high-ranking females, and they have high stress, and they have low CSI scores. It's interesting, though, that when we factor in the presence of kin, if you have kin present, you aren't as much of a loner. You've got someone to hang on. So the possibility is that the loner profile arises only when you've lost your mother, or lost your sister, or for one reason or another, you don't have any close bonds. So are loners the victims of circumstances? And if they are, what kind of motivation would allow females to overcome these circumstances? For example, some nice females have no kin at all, and yet they retain incredibly high nice scores and high CSI, high PSI. Well, we've tested the hypothesis about overcoming circumstances that some individuals are more skilled and motivated than others at forming social bonds. And we're looking for variation in females' responses to social challenges. And there are three kind of challenges I want to talk about. The first is the immigration of a dominant, potentially infanticidal male. Now, in these groups of baboons, the males fight for position in the hierarchy, and your tenure in the alpha position is only going to be about 7 months. before a new male comes in from outside, beats you up, and takes over the alpha position, at which point the new male goes around the group and kills as many of the infants as he can. You all know the story. This causes females who would otherwise spend a year raising their infants, the infant dies, the female comes back into reproductive condition, and the new male mates with the female, effectively replacing another male's infant with his own. We know that when a new male comes in and rises to the alpha position, everybody's glucocorticoids goes up. There's a great stress in the females. But the question is, do they show individual differences? Well, here I've looked at the response of aloof, loner, and nice females, and in each one of these graphs, the dotted line is the zero line. That would be no change in glucocorticoids. And you'll see that almost everybody, in all cases, is above the zero line. Everybody's glucocorticoids goes up when the male comes in. And this is done when the male comes in before he's begun to commit infanticide. But the aloof animals, the stronger your aloof score, you go up less. Same with loners. But nice animals are much more responsive. The more nice you are, the more you will respond to this threat of a challenge. Here's another test. Predation is very high on these baboons, mainly by leopards and lions. And it's often the case that a female will lose a close relative to an attack by a lion. And we're able to measure what she does before and after this attack. And what you find is that females generally increase the number of females that they groom with after they've lost a close relative. They have this adaptive response that reestablishes their bonds. Well, do females differ? Well, here's the relative change in number of grooming partners. Again, the dotted line shows no change, and you can see that the females really differ strikingly. Aloof and nice females, the stronger your score on aloof, the more you increase your grooming partners. The stronger your score on nice, the same. Loners don't do very well at all. They've lost their grooming partner. They don't increase their partners after all. It's not an adaptive response. And finally, the third choice, I won't go into this, but while we're doing all this other work, we've done a lot of work on using playback experiments to test social knowledge in monkeys. And these playback experiments are of various sorts, but they all have the same design. They have an experimental condition in which we present the monkeys, by virtue of a set of vocalizations, with a situation that should get their attention. Either the rank hierarchy has changed, or two animals are forming an alliance against you, or an animal you just fought with is trying to reconcile with you. So if you just don't worry about the details, we've got an experimental condition and a control condition for five different experiments that you can think of as testing social knowledge. And how do the animals respond? Well, again, the zero line is no change between the control and experimental condition. Everybody responds strongly. They all show a positive response to the experimental as opposed to the control condition, but aloof and loners show no significant relation to personality score, but nice animals do show a significant relation to personality scores. So to summarize this, females scoring on nice are most responsive to what we can think of as social challenges. They anticipate threats that haven't yet occurred. They respond more adaptively to setbacks, and they're more interested in social interactions during everyday life. They're really attentive to these playback experiments. These differences are small, sometimes they're not significant, but they go in the same direction in each case. And this supports some work by John Capitanio at UC Davis on captive male rhesus macaques, where individuals with high sociability scores are healthier. They cope better physiologically and behaviorally in unstable situations, and they show better social skills. Now, there is, at the moment, a view that humans differ from all other animals in their motivation to understand and participate in activities in which there are shared goals and different roles, sort of theory of mind tests. But a lot of these tests have typically tested children in a wonderfully rich, typically normal social environment, and non-human primates in an environment that is sort of bizarre in its abnormality. And the argument of these tests is that humans are uniquely pro-social and cooperative. But the data from the field give us a different picture. As I've said, among wild chimpanzees, grooming, coalition, sharing of meat among long-term partners is balanced and reciprocal over time. The services are exchanged in different currencies. You share meat with your best friend on Tuesday, groom with him on Thursday, and go on a patrol on Sunday. Cooperation occurs, especially among long-term partners, and cooperation is sometimes risky. And we now know that cooperation is rewarding. So after chimps hunt monkeys and kill them, they eat the monkey right there, and sometimes there's sharing and sometimes there isn't. You can see this all in Planet Earth, the video. And in two separate studies in Uganda, people looked at the hormonal correlates of sharing. So here's oxytocin in cases where there was a hunt and then meat eating without sharing, and a hunt and meat eating with sharing. And oxytocin, its levels are higher. I should say that they're higher both in the donors of meat and in the recipients of meat. And in another study that's recently been published by Marissa Sobolewski, testosterone, usually associated with aggression, it's higher if there's no meat sharing and lower if there is meat sharing. Again, also lower in both the donors and the recipients. So cooperative behavior in wild chimpanzees under natural conditions without any human intervention, it does occur. It occurs often, and it occurs most often among individuals with strong social bonds. So to conclude, what we would like to argue is that a full-blown theory of mind has evolved from a rudimentary form that is reflexively attentive to others' attentions, emotions, and intentions. This is widespread in animals, and we still see it in humans, in contagious yawning and in the kind of imitative interactions. The rudimentary theory of mind, without the human elaborations, has evolved because individuals who are motivated to attend to each other's behavior and attentional states form stronger social bonds, and these social bonds are directly linked to fitness. So we can form a causal chain between this imitative empathy and the formation of social bonds and reproductive success. And that the individual variation that we see in what we tend to think of as cognitive performances in the lab and reaction to social challenges stem largely from variation in the motivation to participate and interact in social interactions. So the best way to understand the evolution of theory of mind is to argue that it grows out of emotional empathy, because emotional empathy is crucial to the formation of social bonds, which in turn are crucial to fitness. Thank you. And my final plug is that you get these dichotomous differences between theory of mind in animals and humans, but where those come from are where theory of mind in animals is studied in this particular environment. In these other environments, you begin to see a lot more about how and why theory of mind has evolved. I should say that this environment, testing under these conditions, is heavily funded by NIH, and this is programmatically eliminated from all funding by NIH. So there's a problem. I'll be glad to take questions.